was Gospel Tabernacle, an Assembly of God church pastored by her and her husband, and most Sundays she did the preaching. Well, God can't use you because you have not been formally educated. Oh, really? Tell that to Smith Wigglesworth, who probably only had an 8th grade education, if that. How about putting a premium on ignorance? But there will always be those that will try to stop you from getting the blessing you need. Stop you from being restored. Always. Someone will always be there to shut you up because of their own selfish agenda. These Pharisees had no regard for Jesus. They wanted to plot and kill him. They are revival killers. They are people who want to keep the kingdom of God from advancing wherever they are. They resist the move of God, and they do it religiously. We become so obsessed sometimes at Pentecost that everything be done in decency and in order. I like this one. If I had time, I could show you in Scripture. It doesn't mean what most Pentecostals, I don't believe it means what most Pentecostals say it means. But if you talk to most Pentecostals, they'll say, don't have two or three tongue messages in one church service. We're lucky if we have one. Huh? We're better off here than we are a lot of places, believe me. And another thing that sometimes Pentecostals will do, they'll say this. I've heard Pentecostal people say this. Well, the fruits of the Spirit are more important than the gifts of the Spirit. No, they're not. They're equally as important. Despise thou not prophesying, and forbid not to speak in tongues. We need a move of God's Spirit. There are people that are dry, that are withered. They've been hurt, they're damaged. But that day is done. Why? Because Jesus was in the synagogue. The healer was there. The restorer was there. It doesn't matter how broken you've become or another person has become. Remember what he says in Isaiah about a broken reed and a smoking flax. He will not suffer a broken reed and a smoking flax. What does that mean? He'll fix the reed and he'll trim the wick on the flax so that the reed can play beautiful music again, and that the flax can show forth light once again. That's the restorer of Jesus. In Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. Be glad then, ye children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. The floors shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. And listen to what he says. And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm, the caterpillar, the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. Be glad, you children of Zion. You see, when Jesus is in the house, there's the possibility of restoration. When Jesus is in the house, there's the possibility of renewal, revival, and refreshing. He brings seasons of refreshing. He'll renew you. So, you know, Henry David Thoreau, not a man of God, but I'm going to quote him anyhow. Henry David Thoreau said, most men lead quiet lives of desperation. You see, maybe you're desperate. Desperate where your life is right now. Desperate to make ends meet. I love that commercial where the woman says, it's a commercial about buying insurance for your clients. And she said, my refrigerator went on the blink and it's a $2,500 repair. God bless you, if you can afford a $2,500 refrigerator, I ain't never had one. We've been without her already, and we've used an ice chest for a couple days till we could figure out how we were going to get an Been there, done that, bought the t-shirt. How about it? Or the guy that, you know, that same commercial, he says, I sent for air conditioning, God bless you. I had, the only time I had sent for air conditioning is when it was in a parsonage, and I could never get the thing to work right to begin with. It kept the basement where my office was so cold, I needed a jacket to sit down in the summer. Upstairs, it was still hot. Maybe the thing is, how can I make it? What about my relationship? My relationship with a loved one is all, there's no hope for that relationship anymore. Oh, but there's Jesus is in the house. He's the restorer. He's the one. Be glad, you children of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will restore all the years that have been lost. You feel like your life's been wasted? You feel like you've had missed opportunities? Put that aside. Your Savior is here today. And He will restore. He will restore. Now, we had the man with the withered hand. We see the Pharisees and the scribes. We see Jesus in this story, but it doesn't just end there. Now, Jesus could have said, he could have just said, look, guys, you want to see if I can heal? Heal. It'll have been over and done with. He did it before. He spoke the word. Lord, speak the word. And I know you don't have to come into my house. Just speak the word. Miles away, Jesus speaks the word and there's healing. But Jesus said to this man with the withered hand, he said, stand forth. He said, stand up. See, there had to be some action on the part of the man in order for Jesus to bring this restoration. Jesus wanted his participation in this whole affair. He said, stand up. Why did he have him stand up? So that everybody in that room, probably a small room in the synagogue, all jammed in there, the whole town, so to speak, so that everybody could see that he was the man with the withered hand. And then Jesus said to him, stretch forth thy withered hand. I can't. It doesn't work. I can try, but I just can't. What Jesus was saying, don't not only stretch out your hand, he was saying, open up your hand, man. And he could have said to Jesus, I've tried so many times, and it just won't open. It just won't work. Jesus says, stand up, stretch forth your hand. And that's what he's saying to us today. He specializes in impossibilities. Did you ever wonder, when is my prayer ever going to be answered? When is my life ever going to, when am I ever going to feel differently inside? When am I ever going to receive what I think I see in others, what they have spiritually? When is it my turn? Stand up and stretch forth your withered hand. There's no use. This isn't just some old rabbi here today. This just isn't some dude from another town. Why, this is the Savior, Healer, Baptizer. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He is the Creator of all the universe. And if He says your hand is restored, it's restored. Stretch forth thy withered hand. Dave, I've been to the altar countless times. I come all the time and it doesn't seem like anything has changed. Stretch forth your withered hand and cry out to God. And He will restore all the years that the canker hath eaten. why I used to be used in the gifts of the Spirit. Then someone criticized me one day, and now I'm scared. Stand forth and stretch forth your withered hand. Well, I thought I was prompted of God one time, and when I went to the person, they were nasty to me. Stand forth! Stretch forth thy withered hand, and let the Lord bring restoration into your heart, into your spirit. Now, I will be honest with you. I believe there will be restoration for you. But just as there was resistance prior to the restoration, there is resistance after the restoration. It's amazing, these Pharisees and scribes, they knew Jesus could heal. They knew it. They saw it. They heard the story. It wasn't that they just didn't want him to heal on the Sabbath. They wanted him to heal on the Sabbath so they could have find fault with him so that they could bring charges against him. And what did they do after he healed? They went out and conspired with one another how they might kill him. Oh, they're so religious. God bless their hearts. But you have to look away from the resistance. The resistance that would keep you from getting your blessing, and the resistance that will come after you've received your blessing. Will there be resistance? Say to yourselves today, I can't imagine that there will be resistance come. Oh, it'll come. Guarantee it. If you've been told you can't be blessed, you're too old, you're too young, you're too short, you're too tall. You're too fat, you're too skinny. You're too ugly, you smell. Who knows? I don't care what they say. That's fine. They can say you're rotten. My mother used to always say, if someone says you're rotten, say, I'm not rotten, the entire family smells that way. Don't let them keep you today. Say, you know what? I'm not well educated. You don't need me. Brother Benson pastored a very large church in Grand Rapids, Michigan, Pentecostal church, conservative church. But revival broke out. Brother Benson held several doctors and was a very, very well accomplished preacher, an expositor, and a teacher. And during the revival, just what the Lord told him, it's not for everybody, but the Lord told him, I don't want you to prepare your sermons going into the pulpit. I want you to prepare your heart. I will give you what to speak when you get into the pulpit. This was hard for this guy to do that because he was a preacher of preachers. And he said, if you do what I tell you, he felt the Lord say, you do what I tell you, I will bless you beyond Grand Rapids, Michigan. And he did. And for nearly 2 years, God poured out his spirit on that Pentecostal church. Much like our area, a very, very Dutch area, very German area. And here's the end of the story. Not the end of the story for Brother Benson, but Brother Benson was invited. Remember, God told him he would bless him beyond Grand Rapids. Brother Benson was invited to Princeton School of Divinity, a bastion of liberalism, theologically and politically, to speak about what was going on in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and elsewhere in the country when God was pouring out his spirit in the 90s. And Brother Benson stood in that sanctuary and taught for over an hour, probably an hour and a half, he said. And at the end of the message, a gentleman that has been leading this seminar or whatever service said, we're going to ask Dr. Benson to come back to the pulpit, and he will now entertain your questions. Not something he was prepared for. Brother Benson stood in that pulpit, and there was a theologian, a teacher, a professor at the School of Divinity at Princeton, stood up. They all wore their gowns that day. They all wore their funny-looking hats. The man took off his hat, and he said to Brother Benson, "If I come forward, will you lay hands on me that I may have the revival you have in your heart? And will you lay hands on me that I will be baptized in the Holy Spirit that your people are being baptized in?" And Brother Benson said, "Come, come." And God met that old, crusty, dried up, withered theologian right there in the chapel of the Princeton School of Divinity and baptized him in the Holy Spirit. Listen, God wants to water us today. Will you stand with me? Sister Sandy, you come to me. Will you stand with me today? I have no idea what's happening in the hearts of us here today. But if you have any type of frustration in a relationship, in your vocation, in your effectiveness in the kingdom of God, if you feel dry and withered and you want something today and it has to be today, I'm going to ask you to stretch forth your withered hand and come. And let's see what the Holy Spirit will do today. Will you come today? Come. All ye that are thirsty, all you that are hungry, come and let the restorer of the withered hand touch your heart and spirits today. Oh, thank you.